Lengthening trail of irate hosts behind them, the two continued their escape to the north, but their faithful steed began to fail them. Every time they reached a hill, Poderosa balked. His journey she gave up completely at the first steep hill. It was their last day as motorized. A truck deposited them and the crippled Poderosa in the next town, Los Angeles. They found lodging in the local firehouse after chatting up the three daughters of its fire chief. Later, Ernesto paid coy homage to the uninhibited girls as exponents of the grace of the Chilean women who, whether pretty or ugly, have a certain something of spontaneity, of freshness, that captivates immediately. Alberto was more explicit. After dinner, we went out with the girls. Once again, I noticed the different attitudes toward freedom between Chilean women and our own. We returned to the firehouse, lax and silent, each one ruminating on his experience. Fuser made his bed, really agitated. I don't know if from the asthma or the girl. We stepped on a truck headed for Santiago, lugging the carcass of La Poderosa with them like the body of a fallen comrade. The Chilean capital made little impression on them, and after finding a garage where they could leave the motorcycle, they were off again, on their own. As intent as ever on reaching Easter Island, they planned to wangle free passage aboard a ship from the nearby port of Valparaíso. 3. Out at a bar, La Giaconda, whose generous owner fed and housed them for free, the two prowled the port of Valparaíso. They returned disappointed, having been told that the next ship to Easter Island didn't leave for 6 months. But they didn't lose hope, for they had yet to call upon the Society of Friends of Easter Island. Meanwhile, their imaginations took flight with the stories they heard. Quoting some of them, Ernesto wrote, "Easter Island. There to have a white boyfriend is an honor for the females. There, what a wish. The women do all the work. One eats, sleeps, and keeps them content. It mattered to stay a year there. Who cares about work, studies, family, etc.?" In between meals at La Giaconda, they climbed up and down the serpentine steps of the city, amid houses built of colorfully painted zinc overlooking the leaden blue of the bay. To Ernesto, it had an insane asylum's beauty. After making abundant use of his alleged doctor's degree, Ernesto was asked to look in on one of La Gioconda's clients, who turned out to be an elderly servant woman, prostrate with chronic asthma and a failing heart. He found a room where he breathed in an odor of concentrated sweat and dirty feet. She was surrounded by the ill-concealed acrimony of her family, who seemed to suffer her presence badly. She was dying, and there was little Ernesto could do for her. After giving her a prescription for her diet, what remained of his own supply of Dramamine tablets and a few other medicines, he left, followed by the praising words of the old lady and the indifferent stares of her relatives. The encounter affected and led him to think about the heartlessness of poverty. There, in the final moments of people whose farthest horizon is always tomorrow, one sees the tragedy that enfolds the lives of the proletariat throughout the whole world. In those dying eyes, there is a submissive apology, and also, frequently, a desperate plea for consolation that is lost in the void, just as their body will soon be lost in the magnitude of misery surrounding us. How long this order of things, based on an absurd sense of caste, will continue is not within my means to answer. But it is time that those who govern dedicate less time to propagation of their regimes and more money, much more money, sponsoring works of social utility. A few days later, after this affirmed that no ships would be sailing to Easter Island for many months, Ernesto and Alberto reluctantly resigned themselves to their original itinerary. After a fruitless round of the wharves asking for work on board ships, they stowed away on board the San Antonio, a cargo ship headed to the port of Antofagasta in northern Chile. Slipping aboard at dawn, with the collusion of a friendly sailor, they crept into a latrine where they hid.